Well, welcome everybody, and thank you for coming. And it's great to see all the filmmakers that are in this audience, this very select audience. I can tell you that there are quite a few people in this room who are making really good work, and it's so thrilling that you're here to hear what Tony has to say. He's been very well introduced by Esther, so I thought I would just kick into this showrunning role, because Tony runs shows that he created from scratch, and he also runs shows that he did not create from scratch. But it's such an important role, and I would like to ask you about how you, specifically on the slap, how you ran that show, the writing side of it first of all.
I guess when we formed Matchbox Pictures, there were five independent producers, and there was myself and Michael McMahon. We had a company called Big and Little Films, and there was Penny Chapman, who used to be head of television at the ABC, and then two New Zealand producers, Helen Bowden and Helen Pankhurst. And we sort of formed the company with the view to doing things a little bit differently. And at the time, we sort of realised that, the whole idea of the showrunner was relatively new to Australia, because historically what tended to happen was that producers hired script producers who were responsible for looking after scripts, but those script producers would then leave or be stuck behind a desk or would not be involved in other parts of the production process, and yet the producers themselves weren't necessarily creative producers. They didn't necessarily have a singular vision for the show. So then we sort of saw that what was happening in the American system was that the kind of writer-producer was starting to emerge, and
this is what we want to hear: the writer is God.
Yeah,
we laugh
yeah.
It up.
And we sort of thought, oh well, the best work is coming from that model, and it kind of made sense that you would have someone who would be responsible for the creative vision of the show from beginning to end, and The Slap was the first television series I'd ever been involved in, and what we decided, so as a company, what we just did was we had Helen Bowden as, like, she was like the physical producer of the show, but I stepped into the show as and my role was going to be like the showrunner, and so the process was classically I would have been called the script producer. I was there from we had a lot of writers' rooms, and Christoph, because the slap came from a book, there was a lot of material that we had to work from, and then we had to work out how to adapt it. So we had, a fantastically successful book. We had a really great writers' room, phenomenal writers. Alice Bell, who I think is doing some work in New Zealand. Kate Shortland. We had Brendan Cowell, who is a writer / actor / director.
Did you choose your writers?
Yeah,
yourself?
Yeah. No, it was a very carefully curated room.
Yeah.
Emily Ballou, who was a novelist, is subsequently moved to the UK and is one of the hottest screenwriters in the UK at the moment. And then Chris Merkser, who has written a lot of the Underbelly series and a fantastic writer. And so we just all kind of basically sat down and talked about how we were going to, what we were doing. And
yeah, I'd like to get really nitty gritty about this bit just for a second, because it really interests me, and I have never heard of it being done in New Zealand, as thoroughly as I think it needs to be done. So I'm really interested to hear you say that it was your first television series, and that at that time the showrunner was not the role in Australia that it has come to be. So you guys were kind of making it up on your own turf.
Absolutely.
So can you tell us about that day one, you and your writers in the room?
Well, basically we just talked. But,
yeah.
We initially had 2 weeks, and we were, it was a funded 2 weeks, and those rooms are expensive.
Yeah.
So, fortunately, the head of the acting head of drama at the ABC then, a woman called Amanda Higgs, who I then, when she left the ABC, I then asked her to come and work with us on the slap as script editor. She understood the need for that kind of really rigorous development process. And even though the book was there, and we all understood that it was not a necessarily easy adaptation because there was not a lot of story in the book. We had to invent it. You know, if you did the book literally, it would have become quite, you know, it would have been closer to, you know, there was a line between anthology because it, you know, the structure is a rotating series of points of view around one event. You know, it could have anthologized. So a lot of what we were doing in the room was working out how do you turn this from an anthology into a drama series? How do you kind of construct the narrative arcs yet maintain the purity of the point of view of each episode, which is kind of what interested us in the book, and you know what felt very singular in the book and original. So that was kind of the battle that we had, and we just kind of we basically sat and talked about the themes and what the book was about and what we were interested in as a group, and it was incredibly robust.
And all the writers were there for that initial
absolutely,
2 weeks.
Absolutely. So it was quite a big room. It was exciting. What we found was that every time, you know, I had to force people to stop to eat because you know people were so excited. You know, because of the nature of the book, it was so much about, you know, things that everyone could relate to in their personal lives. You know, like, and it was also, you know, it was also really important for us in putting that room together for, you know, like, because the question around the slap is, you know, it's a question around parenting styles, and it's also a question of whether that kid should have been slapped or not. It's about, you know, like about discipline, all of those things. And it was really important for us to have writers who were on the side of one, on the side of Rosie, and also on the side of Harry. So that was always really important. So we weren't prejudging the destination that we wanted to arrive at.
And in that initial 2 weeks, were you actually starting to plot in the episodes?
Yeah. It started happening, you know, probably after about day three. We started talking about, you know, what are we actually going to do?
Yeah.
And we started sketching it out, and really, I would say, as a collective, we probably plotted the first 8 episodes in big picture, and then we went away, did scene breakdowns, and then we came back again, and we had another week where we sort of talked about and discussed the scene breakdowns, and you know, there was some kind of vigorous debate. Probably the most violent debate we ever had was about flashback.
About whether to or not to.
The room divided exactly in half between people who hated flashback and people who didn't care.
What's your position on flashback?
I think it's kind of like, you know, hating the colour red or hating, you know, like I think that, you know, it's a narrative tool and you either do it well or you don't.
Yeah.
But it got quite violent. And we didn't hit each other, but we certainly, you know, I was surprised at how strongly people felt about it. And then...
Who made the ultimate decision? Go with it or don't go with it?
Oh, well, it was kind of me, but
It was you.
But I didn't sort of, you know, it wasn't like we're going to do this. It was, you know, articulated. It was, you know, like, you know, we kind of talked about, you know, what was hilarious was that the person who spoke most passionately against flashback only realised the next day he had flashbacks in his next episode, but he forgot.
He had put them there without realising that he put them there.
Yeah, they were just in there, but he completely forgot. In fact, the whole original end of the series was a flashback.
Yeah.
So then we had a couple of weeks, and then we came back, and we actually had all the first draft, so we came back for a week again after that. So it was a really...
I'm going to talk about this too, because this was something I wanted to talk about, and we've just got there quite naturally. Is time frame and how much time was allotted to each stage of the process. So after your initial, and I know that none of this is set in stone, but I find it really interesting to know quite physically and practically how something as big and ambitious as this 8-part series is made. So I'm interested to talk about it. You had, there was the initial 2 weeks of milling and getting to know each other and shaking down and then actually starting to plot in an episode by episode way. And did you get all the way through? Big picture, 8 episodes in those 2 weeks. Then all the writers did scene breakdowns.
And then we
and how long
back.
Did they get for the scene breakdowns?
I think about 3 or 4 weeks, something like that. They got there earlier, but we came back about 3 or 4 weeks later.
Yeah.
And then we came back a couple of months later after the first drafts.
And but did everybody read everybody's work?
Yeah, absolutely. It was a very... I'd never been in a writer's room before. It was my first experience of it. And it was so illuminating. And it was kind of interesting because there were three of us from whose primary experience had been in feature films. There was Kate Shortland, and there was me, and there was Emily. And none of us had done writer's rooms before, and I don't even think Brendan had done much. And we all just talked about how
that was probably a really good thing.
Yeah, how exciting it was, and how it's a shame that we couldn't write movies like that because it was a very egoless room, and I think that you can't always get that perfect experience.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it was the best experience I've ever had in a writer's room.
Yeah.
But it was very much about putting the best idea on the table, and what was really interesting was watching, for instance, someone would come up with an idea and everyone would say, oh, that's great. And then one person in the room would just tilt their head, and it was usually Kate Shortland. She would just sort of say, I don't think I believe that. And then suddenly everyone would realise, actually, she's right.
Yeah.
And, there was always someone who was, able to kind of spot the phony ideas and the things that felt a little bit like, oh, it just feels like a TV writer's room idea.
Mm.
And we were very alert. We were very alert, and because the show was not that, some shows can be that, and that's what they should be, but this was not a show that was about that. This was a show that was supposed to be talking about people's real life experiences, and the thing that excites me most about television drama is when you can show things that feel absolutely true. But
did
you've
you
never
have
seen
those conversations out loud in the room, like what this show is and what it's not?
Yes. Yeah. Or not so much, not articulated in that way, but absolutely what the show is. Not so much what it wasn't, but certainly what we loved about the book.
The book.
Therefore,
yeah.
What we want, our aspirations for the show.
Yeah.
So then. As the process went on, it became clearer what was the show and what wasn't the show because, the things that I loved about the book and then consequently about the show was, like a character like Harry, episode 3. You just don't, he's a violent kind of wog guy. He's angry, he's violent, but he's quite... he's also fiercely protective of his family. He you just don't see those kinds of uncensored versions of masculinity very often on television. Like that, so we were always conscious of looking for the nuance in characters. Also, a character like Rosie in episode 5, who was
despicable. Could I just ask,
how
many people here saw The Slap on TV3 a few years ago?
Oh, that's lucky.
yeah, that's good. I thought I'd better just ask that. But then you will know these characters, which is great. Yeah, Rosie.
I mean, again, the genius in Christos's book is that he took these people who were very complicated and gave them
even more complicated moral positions. So what we wanted, you know, like when we were structuring it, we were really conscious of wanting to try to keep turning the audience, like to say in one moment, oh, Harry was right, slap that kid, I would have slapped that kid. Or no, he was wrong, you know, and to keep flipping it as the series went on. And one of the issues with the book, which we wanted to try to tackle in a dramatic way, was that people either loved or hated the book. I mean, we auditioned actors, someone who came in to play the role of Rosie, and she just said, oh, I had to throw that book across the room. I hated it so much.
That was ballsy. Did she get the part?
Well, she was a big star, but she didn't get the part.
I'm so glad the woman who got the part got the part. She was awesome.
No, Melissa George, who played Rosie, she loved Rosie. And that's why, you know, she thought that Rosie and Gary had the best, most honest relationship in the series. And we thought, wow. Because they're so fucked up. As a couple, they're so fucked up. But she was right, kind of in her own logic of the character. She was right. They were the only couple that didn't cheat on each other in the whole series.
And she was invested in it.
Yeah, she was saw completely it from invested that, yeah. in the character. But one of the things we did want to tackle was we didn't want to soften any of the characters, but we wanted to make them understandable. Mm. And because I think that, you know, one of the... Sometimes in the novel, I felt like the characters were a little opaque.
Yep.
And so it was easy... Or, more to the point, I felt like it was easy to judge them. So I felt like I judged Rosie in the book, and I didn't want to do that as easily in this TV series. So what we kind of wanted to do, because we had this beautiful structure that went from point of view to point of view, what we wanted to do was try to make it so that, say, in episode 3, when you meet Rosie from Harry's point of view, she is this beautiful, icy kind of monster. But when you see her in episode 5, from her point of view, she's this vulnerable, damaged woman who's trying to do the best that she can, you know, like, so that it sort of flips as the points of view of the series flip.
Yeah. And this comes back to your showrunner role, because it's, I think, one of the most exciting things about it is that it goes through the writing, the idea, the writing, the casting, and the directing, and they're all so essential to each other. And when it's a seamless garment, it's such a beautiful thing to see. So when you had run your writer's room and you'd written your episodes, and after the scene breakdown, I'll try and hurry through this, but how many drafts would a writer typically do?
We did three drafts.
Three drafts.
And a polish at the end of that. And, I did a little bit of invisible mending along the way. And then
Did the network have to respond to each draft? Okay. So as the showrunner, you were receiving all that feedback and taking it back to
and
you.
And my job was to deal with the network notes and to then, negotiate on what I felt was right and what I didn't, agree with.
Right.
And
that was just you, not the producer. It was you?
It was me. Right. I was the producer.
Yep.
So, cool.
Then when you got into production and casting, when did the directors come in?
Jessica Hobbs, beautiful New Zealand director. She was the setup director. She came on board after the scripts were finished, and she did the first two eps, and so she and I did the casting primarily with Helen Bowden, who's the other producer, and the network, we did the casting together, but I was kind of integral to the casting, and then you'd look at all the rushes as it went along, and you'd give feedback to the directors. I mean, like, I guess probably the hardest thing for me at the slap was that I was the third director on, because because I'd never done it before. I stupidly thought that that would be the best position to be in.
Right when you're in the middle of everything
Well, I thought, it's all started, and, so it'll all be running smoothly. And, of course, by the time I got to my block to direct, I was doing notes on the cuts for episode one and two. I was working with the director of the second block, looking at his rushes, and I was prepping my block, which I was supposed to direct, which I often, basically, I didn't do any preparation at all. So I would just turn up to direct, and I wouldn't even know what was on the call sheet. I would just kind of turn up and, that's the scene we're doing, okay.
Just try and remember what you'd said to the other directors.
And then whilst I was in the edit, I was also doing, working on the script for block four as well. It was crazy. That was probably the craziest time. And so now if I did it again, I would know that if you're going to do it, you should be the setup director or you should be the last director.
Right.
But you shouldn't. Being in the middle is stupid.
Have you done it again? You've directed on a show where you've also been
shown? I kind of haven't. I've sort of stepped away from that for the moment, just because I'm doing a lot of EPing and executive producing and setting up shows and sort of looking at I've stepped back a little bit.
Well, would now be a good time to look at a clip from The Slab? I think so. Can we look at the Richie in the vet clinic clip? Would you like to say anything about this before we show it?
This was kind of like episode eight, and it's one of the key moments in the book where everything comes out. And I was terrified when I had to direct this scene because it's such a big, long scene. And it's so close to melodrama, like it's it could have gone either way, but fortunately, I don't think directing is rocket science. I sort of think if you have really great actors and the script works, then that's most of your job done, and you just have to call cut. But
don't tell them. They'll all be doing it.
Yeah.
They are all doing it.
Yeah, but I this was a day that could have gone really, really badly wrong.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you. How's it going? What's this about?
It's about an animal you're married to.
Oh, Gary, don't be an idiot.
Oh, of course. I'm the idiot, because Hector's shit doesn't stink, does it?
You keep your voice down. This is where I work.
You know that Hector raped Connie.
I don't believe that for a second.
Tell him. Go on, tell him.
What do you have to tell me, Richie? What's wrong? Richie seems to think that Hector did something to you, something terrible.
Terrible? He raped her!
Is this true?
No, I swear. I have no idea what he's talking about. What the fuck is this about, Richie? What did you say?
Well, did he rape you or not?
No! I have no idea what he's talking about. He's making it up. I promise you. He's obsessed with Hector. He's sick. He stole a photo out of your album, a photo of Hector, and he stares at it all day. And he goes to the pool just so he can pervert Hector. He's sick. He's fucking sick.
What's going on here, mate?
Richie? Rosie, you take Hugo home. He shouldn't have to hear this. Just fucking go and get out of my life. Go! Is this true? You told all these lies because of some sex obsession with Hector? I'm so ashamed of you. You get up and you say sorry. Get up. Get up! Get up! Rich!
Wow. That's terrific.
Sophie Okonedo is just the most phenomenal actress. We were really lucky to get her. She kind of came on board the project for, you know, because in the book, Aisha character that Sophie plays is Indian.
Yeah.
And we tried everywhere. We even looked in Bollywood. We looked in England, we looked in America, we looked in Canada. We could not find, and there was one actress we desperately wanted, but she was booked on another show, and we couldn't find anyone. And then I made the call at the, you know, like the 11th hour, we needed, the important thing in that role was that she was other, that she was not white Anglo, and she was not Greek, but that she, so we opened it up to other nationalities, and we had a UK casting director, and as soon as we did, he mentioned Sophie, and as soon as we saw her, we just thought, you know, we desperately want her to do it. And fortunately, Robert Connolly, who directed her episode 7, happened to be in England at the time, and he met with her and charmed her into, you know, she was interested in the show. So we were really lucky to get her, but she was just she was incredible to work with.
Yeah. Did the network have to approve your casting choices?
Yeah.
Was there any to and fro about that? Because it's a terrific cast. I mean, just everybody. There's not a weak link. They're wonderful. So you got the people you wanted?
Yeah. No, it was like I said, it was a dream run. You know, the reason it was a dream run, and it hasn't always happened for me subsequent to it, but what I realised is that if you're seeing the same show as the network, then your life is so much easier.
Yeah.
If you're kind of working at odds, like if they thought that they were commissioning something and you think you're making something that's different from that,
it's Is there an experience in your working life that you can talk about that was like that, as you've just said, a real disjunction?
I can't really sort of talk about
it
because I wasn't actually on the show. I started off being involved in the show, but I actually had to pull out.
Right.
But I could see, you know, it became very rocky as a result.
Yeah.
So generally speaking, I've had good experiences. You know, like I've always seen the same show as the network, and it's been the case on Noe Boys, which was the next thing that I actually was the showrunner on, and this new series, Glitch, which is the ABC's first ever adult supernatural show. It was my original concept, and they have completely supported the idea of it from the day one. They completely got it, and they saw the same show.
Has that aired in Australia yet?
It starts filming in 2 weeks.
Oh, right. Okay. Oh, well, let's talk about Nowhere Boys then, because that's another show where you invented it, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we might show a clip from this one before we talk about it, because nobody here has seen it. So we've got the trailer, which is really useful because that will, you know, set up the premise for us, so we're all on the same page with it. So can we see the trailer of Nowhere Boys?
Good morning, bushwalkers. Ready to leave your comfort zones? Jake, Sam, you will orienteer a 7-kilometre walk with Andy and Felix.
Brains are broad. Excellent choice, sir.
There's a shortcut.
Maybe it's not such a good idea to leave the path.
Let's go.
Shortcut to where?
Well, it looked like a shortcut.
It's slipping.
Great. Well done, freak.
Kill a storm.
Run! Run!
Whoa.
Can you tell us how to get to Bremen?
Viv!
I was only gone one night.
Get up! See?
What?
Everyone who knows us has forgotten us.
Dad, can I help you?
Mum?
So then, if we don't exist, we don't have to follow any boring rules.
Woo-hoo! This is great!
Right, out!
It's not just that we've been forgotten.
Mum?
There are whole new lives.
Hello?
Like a different version of the same reality.
I think we're going to be stuck here for the rest of our lives.
Get out of here!
I think there might be forces at play which we don't understand.
But I'll find an answer. This is all a fantasy. We have to wake ourselves. Watch this. We should stick together.
Stop! Police!
Whatever's going on happened to all of us.
Open the door! What's that? Something out there!
I think it's some kind of evil spirit.
There's no such thing as ghosts. A spell has to be cast by someone. The question is, what spell and who cast it?
Why are you following me?
You boys have a demon after you. Created to restore the natural order after a magical disturbance.
What?
Behold, the elemental talisman. It can protect against attacks.
Come on, we've got to get out of here!
Aid at my quest. I call you forth.
Is this the only thing that can protect us?
Destroy the talisman, you'll return to where you belong.
I can't.
Then you will never go home.
The talisman's protecting us, Sam.
Mia's right. You'll see.
Guys, get out of here! Come on!
I just want to go home.
I saw the first two episodes today. It's really fun. Where did this come from, Tony?
It's a real stoner idea, isn't it?
They don't usually admit to that in public sessions.
No, what happened was my company, Matchbox, Penny Chapman, made this show called My Place, which was this beautiful piece for the ABC3, which is the children's network. The commissioning editor at the time, Simon Hopkinson, I met him at our company office, and he said he'd spent all summer reading the ABC was looking for a show for teenage boys, and he'd spent all summer reading things, and he couldn't find anything. And I said, "Oh, well, what are you after?" And he said, "Oh, he was looking for something like Dexter or Breaking Bad for teenage boys."
Right.
I'd never worked in children's TV before, so, it hadn't really ever occurred to me, but, I'd made stuff like The Slap. Yep. Or I'd made stuff about, HIV AIDS or being gay, I'd done stuff that was kind of closer and darker to me. But that pitch sort of stayed in my head for, for several days, and then a couple of days afterwards, I just thought, "Oh, what if you were trapped in another dimension and you were never born?" and then I just the idea just popped into my head during commercial break or something, and I couldn't stop thinking about it. And then so I then sort of span that out. I was in post production on The Slap at the time, and
so just, not very busy.
But I just kind of I span it out into a story. And I just wrote it up one weekend.
Yeah.
And
what did you write up? How much detail did you go into?
Two pages.
Right. Yeah.
And I just, showed it to the rest of my company, and everyone thought it was good. And so then I sort of developed that into a five or six page pitch.
Yeah.
Which I showed the ABC, and they really liked it. They put some money into it, and then it just kind of took off from there.
Yeah. And obviously you're the series creator.
Yeah, but like Slap, I didn't actually write any of it.
Oh, okay. But in the formulating stages, like as you say, you wrote first of all your two-pager and then your five-pager.
Yeah.
So were you expressing in those, I would expect that you were, tell me, what were you expressing in those documents? It was sort of...
the key idea, implications of the idea. Did you say who your characters were?
Yeah.
Did you give any plot?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So you did a lot. I came
up with the plot. I came up with the characters. I came up with the scenario. We worked in a writer's room. We thrashed it all out. Then one of the other writers and I sort of bashed the Bible backwards and forwards to each other. We had a fully fledged Bible, like we had 13 episode outlines, so it was pretty well developed by the time the writers.
So you bowed out at episode writing stage, but you'd been very instrumental until that point.
Yeah.
And then were you the person that the scripts came to and you tutted with them and?
I kind of did, like I think that, as a showrunner, you do have to do, part of your gig is if the script is not the show, then you have to make it the show. That's part of the deal.
And what were your key words or phrases or concepts? Like, what did you say to your writers so that they would get what the show was, the thing you had dreamed up?
I think early on, I mean, because the concept was quite dark. We were always conscious that we wanted it to be a balance of like light characters in a dark situation. So fun was always the word adventure, but to kind of have heart as well. So to kind of be and also to be truthful. I think that for me the best high concept stuff always is grounded. It's always grounded in what would a real person do in this situation, and that was always the principle we brought into the plotting room. That was like, well, this is absolutely impossible. But if you were in this impossible situation, what would you do?
Yeah.
And the other thing that I was a real Nazi about was because it involves magic rules. Because I feel like if you understand the genre, and I'm a real nerd when it comes to this kind of genre stuff, you have to be really rigorous about the rules of genre. Yeah. You can't suddenly use magic to solve a plot problem.
Yeah.
And whenever we did, I would just have a big red line and say, you can't do that. And you would know. You kind of instinctively know when you're kind of creating a new rule of magic to solve a plot problem.
Get yourself out of a hole.
Exactly. So that was always a no-no. And but it was, again, I had a fantastic experience on that on the show. It was really hard work because it was a first for me. I'd never worked in children's television before. Yeah. Budgets are really tight. And the show is really ambitious because it had a lot of action. It had visual effects, special effects. It had a big ensemble cast,
Some of them are they quite new to the game? Some of your actors?
Yeah. The Chinese boy, he was actually the kid in my feature film, Home Song Stories.
He's delightful. I mean, the character is delightful.
Yeah, he's a very charming actor. And, the degree of difficulty was quite high and the bar was quite high in terms of realising it. And we wanted to give one of the things we really wanted to do on it was to give a lot of people first-time experience in television because because it's really hard to get that first kind of first gig. And so we had, a whole bunch of writers who'd never written for TV before, and we had three of the four directors had never directed for TV before.
That is so good to hear. So that is really good to hear.
Well, it felt like it was an important thing for us to do, and because I was showrunning it and I'd just done The Slap, and The Slap was a big success.
So it was your call who the directors were, essentially?
Yeah. There were some kind of limitations because of the budget, we couldn't import any directors.
Yeah.
So they all had to come from Melbourne. But essentially, we really wanted to give people a go.
Yeah. And so you were involved, as the showrunner and creator, you were involved in casting the directors, casting the actors, all the casting way through all departments.
And what I did in both shows that I kind of ran, which is probably what I would always do if I was doing that job again, was there's a producer's edit, so I kind of went in and recut after the directors left, so I could sort of make it what I wanted to be.
Right. I'd like to show, let's have a look. Can we show the other clip from Nowhere Boys? Because this scene really made an impression on me when I was watching this afternoon, because I think the premise is really fun and engaging and it makes you feel curious. But it was during this scene that it landed with me emotionally, the implications of this idea. So I think it's a terrific scene and performance.
Oh, sorry.
Mum? Mum! Mum, it's me.
Sorry?
It's me.
You were following me, weren't you?
It's Jake, your son.
Oh, I don't have a son. Please, what do you want?
Sarah, everything okay? What are you doing here?
How can we help you, son?
I wouldn't use that word.
What's wrong?
Please, I'm not your mum, please.
Are you two married?
Sarah, what's going on?
When did that happen?
That's none of your business. Who are you anyway?
I'm no one. Sorry.
You okay?
So it's really fun, but it's also really, really deep as well. I wonder, because we don't have, we are going to take questions, but we've just got a few more minutes, if that's okay, because we started late. I wonder if you could talk about something that we talked a little about it before at dinner, this thing of the writer's voice and what your own voice is and how difficult it can be to identify it and to hold on to it, because as you've heard, Tony's a very prolific guy, and I feel envious when I think of a working world that's that busy and when that there are that many opportunities. But obviously also there are difficulties, and this is one for writers, whether they're busy or not busy. It's one of the biggest things we struggle with, so I wonder if you would talk about that.
I guess, or I can contextualise it a bit, because over the last year I did Nowhere Boys, and I directed a movie called Cut Snake, and I finished that sort of like mid-year, and for the rest of this year I've sort of stepped back a bit, and I've mainly worked on sort of developing new ideas and selling things to networks. And, you know, like one of the things that, and so more kind of like executive producing, and as a company, Matchbox is always looking for writers, like, and we're always looking for ideas, because, you know, that's basically our job. There's a kind of paradox, which is that if you're writing in for television, most of the time what your job is to try to emulate the voice of the originator of the show, or you know, the head writer or the showrunner, you're trying to write like them, and you do best if you do write like, if you can mimic. But as a seller, you know, like someone who has to sell projects to networks, what I know is that people are always looking for an original voice, an original idea, and even though the New Zealand industry is small, I think the Australian industry is small, but there's still, I think that people are always looking for the network talk is, you know, the word is an idea that pops, something that pops, you know, like, yeah, something that stands out. And to do that, you do have to have an original voice as a writer. And part of the struggle in this business is to try to remember, to hear what your voice is, to then understand the market well enough. I mean, I guess that's what my job is at the moment, to understand the market well enough to then be able to take that voice and then sell it, yeah, to someone, get someone
looking
to make
for
it.
For that beautiful place where what you want to do is what is they want to, yeah, buy.
Yeah, yeah. The other thing I would sort of say is that I recently went to LA and, you know, because the Americans, NBC is doing a version of The Slap, and there's kind of, you know, it was really exciting being in a proper market where there is actually, you know, where there is I think the world is now increasingly about the aggregated niche. I think that even in America, the big networks are not finding the kind of cut through that they, you know, they used to own the audience, the broad audience, but that broad audience is fragmenting, and I think the good thing about that is that the kind of work that probably you and I respond to, there's a big enough market for that, particularly in America, but also aggregated internationally as well. There's a big enough market to actually make and pitch those kinds of ideas, you know, and all the different sort of variations and subsets of them, and that's quite exciting, because, you know, like I met with David Levine at HBO, who did True Detective, and his pitch was that, you know, he wants the most exciting, most stimulating, most original idea that you can think of. That's what they want, and the kind of the funding model of, say, Premium Cable is actually all about cut through. It's all about making things that are noisy and that people will talk about, and that, you know, because they don't need the actual, you know, numbers. You know, they don't have to appeal to the broadest possible audience. What they have to do is convince people to subscribe to their network.
Yeah.
And so it just felt like, I mean, the caveat is that you can never do a bad meeting in LA. Everyone loves you. Everyone loves your shoes. Everyone loves what you're wearing. Everyone. But it did feel as though, you know, like, it did feel as though that there were exciting times, and particularly in the television medium. I think, you know, I did meetings with around feature films as well, and it was kind of a little bit more depressing because everyone was talking about, you know, underlying material and elevated genre. You couldn't talk about drama anymore, and movie stars. That's basically what films are. You know, like and you know, like even things like rom coms, they're too hard now. You know, so it was all about, you know, sort of thrillers with Liam Neeson, and you know, but in television, it was kind of, you know, like it felt like there were exciting times. And going back to that original question, to get noticed in that world, it is absolutely about the originality and authenticity of your voice. It's about what you can bring to the page that hasn't been seen before, or doesn't feel like it's a, it's, you know, a mishmash of other things that other people have seen, but also yet has this craft and the skill to understand, you know, like, you know, where it fits in the world. Yeah. So you know, and that feels like, you know, that feels like an exciting time for writers.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to throw it open now. We've got about 10 minutes left for your questions for Tony. If you have any, please do ask him things, because I always worry that I haven't focused on the one crucial thing that somebody came to hear. So now's your chance.
Elevated genre is basically genre that delivers at a higher kind of level. So genre that has, say, an emotional impact, or, you know, like, so it might be a thriller, but it might be an intellectual thriller, a thriller, you know, that makes you think, or a thriller that makes you feel. So it's kind of like something safe that the studios or the producers can hang on to. Like, oh, this is like. I met with Focus, and they talked a lot about elevated genre. They talked a lot about Looper, for instance, as a film, as an example of that. So something that is familiar, but also delivers on top of that.
More questions?
I think that we're still working it out, really. I would never, if I was on a set, I would never, I think it's the director's job to communicate with the actors. I'd communicate with the director, but I do know that it's different in America. A friend of mine is now the producer-director of New Girl, in the American system, it's very much about the showrunner, and I think it is a different system. I think, say in Australia, I think we would still go through directors in terms of relationship with actors, because otherwise it can get a bit confusing.
Do people still like you at the end?
I mean, I loved Breaking Bad, but I just don't know much about the behind the scenes. So, I do think that, there are lots of different personality types who work within our business, and some probably get loved more than others.
There's a really interesting book apropos of this question. Have you read it, Nick? It's called Difficult Men. And it's about, several of those series. It's about Mad Men and The Sopranos and Breaking Bad and Deadwood. You know, just this brilliant American television from the last 10 to 15 years. And about the creators of those shows and how they created those shows. And they were not all lovable. They were difficult men, and they created shows about difficult men. But the common thread was that each one was the god in his own universe. You know, the creator was the source and the ultimate arbiter. And I think that's as it should be. Do you think that's as it should be?
I hope so. I don't know. I think sometimes it's, you know, I think it's often right. I was also thinking, I did have something to say about, that's right, there's a documentary that is coming out about showrunners, which I can send Esther the link to, and she can sort of...
Is it a series? Because I've actually seen some of a show about writing tables on television, which sounds like a very similar thing.
Right. No, I think this is a one-off documentary.
Oh, cool. I would love to see
all of those people. And that also might give you more of an insight into the Breaking Bad model. Because David Simons, who did The Wire, you know, he was kind of... Yeah, he was notorious for being difficult. Yeah. And
he's another case study in this book.
Matt Weiner, who does Mad Men.
Yeah.
He's kind of like, you know, it's also interesting because I was on a panel with Glenn Mazzara, who did Walking Dead a couple of years ago, and he was the showrunner on the second series. It wasn't his idea, but he got brought in, and he did a lot of overwriting, but never took credit. Whereas Matt Weiner takes credit on every episode of Mad Men. So I think that, you know, it varies.
More questions?
I kind of feel like it's probably the best time at the moment as we discussed over dinner, the New Zealand market's very small, and I think it's kind of, you know, it's hard to you know, you reach a limit pretty quickly, and I would sort of say that's true of the Australian market. Even though it looks bigger, it's still, you know, it's still tiny. You know, we have five broadcasters, and, you know, to go to, and then cable. So there are sort of like six doors that we can knock on with any project. So, but when you go over to America, there are hundreds of doors to knock on. I think the one of the things that, like, my company got bought out by NBC Universal at the beginning of the year, and 2 years before that, they they bought part of the company, and now they fully own the company. And one of the reasons that they did that was I think all of the American market suddenly became aware that the rest of the world is a significant place. It took them a long time to work that out, but they actually started noticing that that sales of their shows were they weren't dominating the world in the way that they used to, because all of this great work was coming from, you know, like, you know, Australia and Israel and, you know, France, and, you know, so they were actually starting to notice, and so they started formatting other shows. So, you know, like Homeland was one. And so suddenly that made them aware of the international. I think in feature films they'd been, you know, that had been, you know, I think a lot of those boundaries are breaking down. And I think so when one of the things that happened when I was in LA was that people were saying, oh, we can't find enough writers in America. We need to look internationally for writers now.
Simple, practical question on that note. If you're a writer from a very small country like New Zealand, wanting to pitch yourself in bigger places like Australia and America, is it essential to have an agent in order to meet with anyone and do anything? Can you get onto the board without one? Or is it you just got to have one?
It's kind of hard because, I mean, the problem is it's a filtering process, really, because if, I mean, we don't take unsolicited submissions at Matchbox because, you know, we just have enough, we don't have the resources to look at everything that people send us.
Yeah.
And it's the same with meeting people, you know, like, we don't have the time or the resources to meet with everyone who, you know, knocks on the door. So having an agent is like one way of filtering. So if it's an agent that we have a relationship with who takes on a client, then that kind of means, well, you know, that's someone, they've already done a bit of pre-filtering for you, and then you can sort of work it out. So I do think that's kind of what the reality of it.
Yeah.
just in case anyone was interested. We may have time for one or two more questions. Has anyone got a question? Yes.
Well, I think you said it in one. I think it's been phenomenal time, and the ABC their drama budget tripled or something. I don't know exactly how much, but it got much bigger, and now it's getting much smaller. And I think it's going to be much leaner. They're going to be leaner times, and unfortunately, because we are so subsidy driven in Australia, the impact of that goes right across ripples right across the market, because it will affect the commercial broadcasters as well in a different way. Everything contracts. There's less opportunity, there's less talent discovery, there's less actor experience, everything gets smaller. So we just have to brace ourselves.
That's not a happy ending. But it's a challenge, and it's what we're living with. Tony, thank you so much for talking to me and to us.
Thank you. So thank you to the New Zealand Film Commission and the ASB Community Trust who fund us to keep running these events, to Images and Sound and White Studio, and to the Pullman Auckland. And thank you all for coming very much, and most of all, thank you to Fiona and Tony. Eloise gave you a survey, which is just one of the things that helps us kind of keep ticking over and providing stats to our funders, so if you can fill it out, we'd very much appreciate it. I think we've ordered fries, so if you're hungry, come down, grab a drink at the bar and have some fries. And Tony is also going to take a very informative 3-hour session on writing compelling drama for young people on Saturday morning, for us and for kids on screen. So please go onto our website and find out and come along to that, because I actually think even if you're not writing drama for young people, you're writing drama for anyone, it's going to be really informative. But it's an area that that kids on screen have been advocating very hard for in New Zealand, and that I know that there has been some funding earmarked from New Zealand On Air for young drama, and which is exciting. And so come along to that as well. Thank you again, and most of all, thank you guys.